From the album Low Live, featuring Chris Drever, Martin Green and Aidan O'Rourke, released under Navigator Records, that was Low and Antobar. That's an excerpt from the track Frankenflow set on that album. And you're listening to The Garden Sessions. Welcome, gardensessions.co.uk. Contact us at podcast@gardensessions.co.uk. We're also available at 98.8 in the Edinburgh area, Leith FM, where Leith lives. I'm Jack Foster, and joining me, as ever, yes, he's back. We're talking about the Niles and Fraser Crane of the Scottish folk scene. That's Dave Engels Gimble and Frank Burkitt. Welcome back to the country.
It's cracking to be back, actually.
You reckless gallivanter.
How did you feel Silver did in your stead?
Well, he did well. The seat's still warm. But
I've noticed that, a bit actually.
He did. To be honest, he had quite a lot to take on, because he had to take on the whole live birthday bash. I missed that, unfortunately, which sounded pounding, boys. Good
and
job.
And also, not only did he take on the live birthday bash, but pretty much ran the show.
Yeah.
I mean, he was the genius behind that.
He was. It was his brainchild.
Fantastic, but I'm good. I'm glad to be back.
Frank, you're back now. What's on the show? Tell us.
Oh, thank you. Folky news, angle, download chart, letters, and another report from Tom's folk odyssey.
It's
we say it's a report. It's more of a just something that he recorded.
Possibly a mistake. We've also got a very, very, very good feature from Knock and Garlic World, Kaylee 2008. Frank, you missed that as well. Where were you? You were in the country. Why didn't you do everything in your power to be at Knock and Garlic?
I was in the country, but I'd literally
believe you were
flew
in the country.
It started on the Thursday, I believe. It was what day longer this time, wasn't
it? It was Thursday to Sunday.
It started on the Thursday. I flew in on the Thursday after a
34-hour flight.
You should have just carried on going.
No, it was just wouldn't have been possible. I just would have stayed in my tent asleep.
It's a lack of dedication that I used to have. I've learnt You haven't.
Are you saying you've lost all lack of dedication, Dave?
To Knockingorick, yes.
Okay. Okay, yeah, so that's all coming up in the show. But for the time being, though, Dave, what's coming up music-wise now? We've got a wee treat.
We do
now,
have
immediately,
a wee treat.
In the present, now.
It's
what's happening?
Well, new in about recording. 20 seconds.
It's a new recording from Kate Rusby, and it's a recording of the classic Sandy Denny track, Who Knows Where the Time Goes.
Rusby, who knows where the time goes. Originally recorded for the BBC series Jam and Jerusalem, this was released as a two-track single along with Elf and Night, and the song was written, of course, by Sandy Denny, and the folk scene marked the anniversary of her death just a couple of weeks ago. And I have to say, it's a fitting tribute. I've heard many covers of Who Knows Where the Time Goes, but that one's very,
that
very
was lovely. It was really, really nice.
Frank.
It's news. It's folk.
What is it, Frank?
It's the folky news. And the folky news brought to you this week, as ever, in association with Paddy Bort's Wee Folk Club.
Well, every Sunday night at the Oak, we've got the Wee Folk Club at 8:30, an intimate venue, 30 seats, acoustic. It's a great night out. We've got fantastic musicians and singers. Every Sunday night, do come along.
Thank you, Mr. Bort.
Can I just say...
You always just say at the beginning of the news.
It's so simple, but Silver couldn't get that bit of jingle and chat right the entire time. It's good to have you back doing the folky news, Frank.
Sunday the 8th of June at the Wee Folk Club, Armand Greenway, a man who's performed for lords and ladies, princes and princesses, in the post office tower in London, in Exeter Cathedral, and on a prison island in the South China Sea. More info, Royal.
Why was he there?
Dashfolk.com.
More info, Royal-Folk.com.
You'll find out at Royal-Folk.com. The top story this week. Emily Smith's new album, Too Long Away, was launched on Saturday at Edinburgh's Coda Music on the Mound to a packed shop floor of folkies eager to hear the follow-up to Emily's previous albums, A Different Life and A Day Like Today. After a short set with her longtime musical partner and co-producer of Too Long Away, Jamie McLennan, Jack caught up with Emily and asked her how the new album differs from her previous work.
This one, I guess I've just come a step further on in terms of my own songwriting. On this album, there's five self-penned tracks. And maybe not quite as in a traditional genre. There's maybe a little bit of a step away from that. But also there are five traditional tracks on there as well. And I guess the main difference is that there are no instrumental sets on this recording.
Do you think that it's important to bring in influences that aren't necessarily so traditional into the stuff you record and perform?
I think it's on my part, it's not really a conscious decision, but I think you can't help but soak up what you listen to, and that's just bound to come out in my own music. So I listen to a lot of traditional music, but I also listen to a lot of American folk music and Americana and country music and bluegrass and some... I'm just like a bit of a sponge, and you know, you soak it all up and it all just sort of comes out again.
You're doing a lot of touring at the moment. What's in line for the upcoming months?
At the moment, we have been touring quite a lot, and at the moment we're really concentrating on doing a lot of radio promotion. We've got a few Radio 2 shows that we're going to be on. I've just recorded a session with Mike Harding, and going to be on Bob Harris and Alla Jones's Good Morning Sunday show. So although we're not gigging so much.
Of course, you had the Radio Scotland Album of the Week.
Yes, I was just thrilled to be Album of the Week on Ian Anderson's show, and also been on Robbie Shepherd, and we're going to be doing a Take the Floor broadcast. So June is mainly...
Take the Floor doesn't seem to be entirely in line with the sort of stuff that you're doing. But
I don't know. We just got the phone call the other day, so I'm really happy to go and do it. We're doing the broadcast from bigger. So June is mainly radio, although we're playing in Glasgow on the 12th of June with the full band. So that's the next big gig, so to speak.
It's new, this couple, they ain't got married, and Ron and Ail lose between them twa, and the sailor lads, they aye come drinking, tae the bleacher lads.
A lot of festivals that you're performing at are lined up, although with one glaring omission, which is from your homeland of Dumfries and Galloway, the Knockingorrick Festival, which is still never seemed to appear in the lineup for. Is there any plans in the future for attending?
Well, yeah, do you know, I think it's just, we've never really, I guess there's a bit of a feeling like, oh, it's in our home region. I'm always going to live in Dumfriesshire, so you know, there's no big rush, but I would love to play it sometime, because it's obviously a growing festival, and the Wicker Man as well, you know, is a huge event in Dumfries and Galloway, so we'll get there one day, hopefully.
Well, thanks very much for joining us in the Garden Sessions, Emily Smith.
Thank you.
And as you heard in that report, Too Long Away was Ian Anderson's Album of the Week on BBC Radio Scotland. It received the same accolade from Channel 4.com. Emily Smith was also the BBC, so I turned into a Dalek briefly there, was also the BBC Young Traditional Musician of the Year 2002 and was one of the Garden Session Songs of the Year 2006 with her rendition of Robert Tannehill's Lay Me on the Wintry Lee. And some exclusive news for Emily Smith, listen up. And some exclusive news for fans of Emily Smith's work on Dr. Freeman's Complete Songs of Robert Tannehill. After having worked the song into her live sets, she intends to record her own take on Fly Away to Some Desert Isle when work begins on her next album. More info at emilysmith.org. The second story this week, Leith Folk Club celebrated its 200th concert and four-year anniversary at the weekend. Dave spoke with the club's secretary, Jim Welsh, and musical publicity officer, Martin Finnegan, after the event and asked them how important organisations like Leith Folk Club are in the furthering of the folky cause.
We provide a platform, small though it might be, with a 65 capacity, for musicians to come down and ply their trade, and we try to promote young upcoming talent, or not necessarily young, but new upcoming talent, as well as providing the very best of folk, blues and acoustic music generally.
Martin, as Jim says, you have a lot of young talent as well as established artists. Do you feel that the young talent that's coming through these days holds water with the established talent on the folk scene at the moment?
The standard of playing, musicianship and performance that we see in here week after week is just quite staggering. I mean, Scotland is becoming something of a machine that just produces musician after a wonderful musician. And one of the things we try to do here, is balance the sort of established acts who, we know we can bring in a good crowd with the younger musicians that our audience, we know will enjoy and will kind of trust us to pick and promote.
And Jim and Martin can also be heard alongside Kenny Delaney on Leith FM's Music Roots show on Sunday afternoons from 2 o'clock.
Worth a listen.
It is worth a listen.
We have to mention as well, actually, it was you launching your album that night.
It was actually.
Your evening.
We'll sneak on in quickly. I did have a part to play in the 200th show of Leith Folk Club. I was launching my own album at the said anniversary. And it was a fantastic evening. I had a really good time. It was a great crowd.
Good to see that album out now.
Yes, it's
little
finally,
less care.
It's thanks for the plug, Jack. Yeah, the bustle you could hear in the background of that report with my fans. You know,
there was, all right,
there
Frank,
was at
on
least
with the
six
news.
People in the room as well.
Congrats, but on least, with the news.
At least six people. More information can be found at Leith Folk Club and leithfolkclub.com, basically, if you want to find out more about Leith Folk Club and the gigs they do and the show on Leith FM. Finally, Edinburgh's Grand Old Opry of Folk, the Royal Oak, has announced the lineup for this year's Festival Folk at the Oak.
Yes.
Which will run, as always, as part of the Edinburgh Festival Fringe. We'll obviously be bringing you more over the coming months. But to whet your appetite for the moment, we can reveal that amongst those appearing this year are Martin Boland and Alan Hunter, Tom McConville, Aaron Jones, Doghouse Roses, former Garden Sessions number one Jim Malcolm, Ian Bruce, Paul McKenna Band, Ali and yes. Wee Mickey Vass, Sin Sheen, Jill Bowman and Nick Keir, to name but a few. More info, royal-oak-folk.com. Keep up to date with all the folky news at gardensessions.co.uk/news. That's the folky news. I've missed the jingle. Give it to me.
The official Garden Sessions download chart. The official Garden Sessions download chart.
Can I just say, Dave, before you start, that I'm delighted to just be here in this room watching you about to do the download chart.
Thanks for that.
I really am.
Shut up.
I love it.
This is the official Garden Sessions download chart based on free downloads from gardensessions.co.uk. At 10, it's a re-entry for Frank Burkitt with Murphy.
He's everywhere.
Good start.
He is indeed. At 9, it's well down done. 2 for the Arrows with Steel Melter Sun.
Sam the Steel Melter Sun. I walk ever on my own. I keep the coal fires burning bright. Hoping I will lead to my eye. Me and my followers, we work as slaves. Feel the death is counting our days. And I know we won't be free to rest until we breathe our last breath.
At 8, it's up 2 for Behold the Field of Megaliths with Weir. At 7, up 1 for Andy Chung with The Wee Room.
Yes.
At 6, it's a non-mover for Scott Gardner with Breamy's Bonnie Doctor.
Oh, are the maiden o'er the place no pen could her portray, an England to her winsome face, it stole my heart away. And Breamy's bonnie daughter were all I ever saw. Geordie Wilson's bonnie Maggie, she stole my heart away.
At 5, it's another non-mover, the Paul McKenna Band with Take My Hand.
Cheers, McKenna.
Yes.
At 4, it's down 1, Sinead Connolly with Eileen O.
She's still there.
She is indeed.
She does. Has she left the top 5 in about the last year?
It seems like
I want answers on my desk.
But even
Dave,
if it hadn't been the last 2 weeks, it would seem like she'd been there for ages. At 3, it's
ooh,
down 2.
Harsh.
For The Arrows with Black is the Colour, which means have a new number one. We have a new number,
one.
It's incredibly exciting.
How exciting, Dave?
It's exciting enough that I can hold off a minute to tell you that at 2, it's a non-mover for Andy Chung with The Penny Falls, which means the Garden Sessions official number one
must be.
Up 3, Frank
Burkitt. Yes!
Frank Burkitt!
Might have had something to do with the album launch.
It might have, bad doubt.
Might have had something to do with the album launch. It might have. Yeah.
And it's Working Hands.
Working Hands. From the album Little Less Care.
Yeah.
Well, that seems like a rather a big plug, but honestly, folks, it's not rigged. Briefly.
It's Frank Burkitt, Working Hands!
There lived a boy who was coming of age. He spent his days in his father's field learning the farming trade. He asked one day, "Father, why must I tend the corn?" His father said, "That's the way it's been for all the sons new born." And at that point the boy looked down and he saw the mud on his shoes, and he felt a pain that for the rest of his days he'd be laboring away his blues. There was a world beyond his father's golden land, and he swore he'd be the first of the sons to rest his working hand. The boy stood firm and he said to his father, "I must not leave this world, having only seen the two cornfields that made our families a word." And then his father said, "Let me tell you what my father told me. Make friends with the land, my boy, and you will truly be free." And at that point the boy looked down and he saw the mud on his shoes, and he felt a pain that for the rest of his days he'd be laboring away his blues. He knew there was a world beyond his father's golden land, and he swore he'd be the first of the sons to rest his working hand. Despite the wise words of his father ringing out loud and clear, the whisper of the dusty trail was louder in his ear. So as he turned to shake his father's earth-stained hands, he said farewell to the endless hours of working the land. And the days went by and the boy forgot the sight and the mud on his shoes, and he lived a life so rich and full, he thought he was rid of those blues. He knew there was a world beyond his father's golden land, and he swore he'd be the first of the sons to rest his working His mother cried, "Your father can't remain the keeper of the land, my boy, for he has succumbed to pain. No longer can his old limbs push the plow. We are praying every day that you will be homeward bound." And at that point the boy looked up and he knew that he must return. thought to lose in the land, and his father made his stomach churn. He'd had his fill of a world beyond his father's golden lands, but now he knew he must return to use his working hand. Many suns have set since his father's passing day, and now the boy finds a son of his own desperate to say, "Father, I must leave the land and let my soul be free. I'm afraid, son, what you see before you is your destiny." And at that point the boy looked down and he saw the mud on his shoes, and he felt a pain that for the rest of his days he'd be laboring away his blues. He knew there was a world beyond his father's golden land, and he swore he'd be the first of the sons to rest his working hands.
From the new album by Frank Burkitt, featuring the virtuosic talents of Chris Stone and Holly Downs. That's Frank Burkitt and Working Hands, and Frank Burkitt sitting directly opposite me because he co-presents this show and he's the number one of the download chart.
I'd just like to point out the notes were a bit wrong. Holly Downs didn't feature on that song. Just me and Chris. Sorry, just thought I'd tell you now.
Might as well chuck
save
fine.
You writing a complaint later on.
Steal Holly's glory from her and give it, pile it back
she
onto
had
yourself.
No glory.
You
she wasn't
head. All right, anyway, it was a lovely tune anyway. It's a great album as well. Well worth a purchase.
Would you really like a couple of hints?
No.
Yes.
No, I don't want one. I think I'm pretty, no,
right,
I'm pretty
Frank,
sure what it is.
Frank, put,
if you
could
give
hands,
us a hint in
6 seconds,
Dave.
One of the people performing on this song has already been mentioned in the show.
My goodness.
Is it Sandy Denny?
It is Sandy Denny.
Is it Fairport Convention?
It is Fairport
no
Convention.
No way.
Is it Crazy Man Michael?
Funnily enough, you've got the same notes I have.
Oh. Shall I press the button to make it start?
Go for your life.
Slap it on.
Not Keeper of the Garden Sessions, Keeper of the Garden, I think was the last line there. Fairport Convention, Crazy Man Michael from the classic album Legion Leaf, originally released in 1969. And from all those years ago to right here now, Dave, what is your angle?
It was a shameless radio link.
It was. I've been listening to a lot of Radio 4 this week, and sorry, it must have rubbed off.
That's what happens. Well, basically, it's a song about Michael, who's a bit mad. He is within the fire and out upon the sea mad. That's
within the
mad.
Fire and out. That sounds like the work of a crazy man.
It's not a PC description of his insanity.
No.
But
and he meets a raven.
The song's called Crazy Man Mike.
It is.
It's not our fault.
It's not that PC. He meets this raven who he gets into a bit of a chat with.
That definitely sounds like
a bit crazy.
Talking to a raven.
The raven says to him, look, I'm going to tell you your future. You know, you've asked me about your future, so I'm going to tell you.
Magpies, they can only predict a few months. Ravens, your whole future.
You've got the whole future. Basically, the raven tells him that your true love's going to die by your own hand, and you'll be cursed.
Tells him that he's going to kill his true love.
Yeah.
The raven's saying this.
So Michael's a bit unhappy, and he's ranting and raving, and he's like kind of beating his fists against the wind kind of thing.
Uh-huh.
And he's shouting, and he's swearing, and he's laughing, and he's crying, and he's just going completely mad.
Going through all the emotions.
Because he's trapped inside his own head with this terribleness that
in the middle of the
wife.
Sea
that the ravens told him.
Yeah, so he turns around to the raven and says, no, you're talking evil, you're talking with you're just talking out of spite. It's terrible.
If you were to speak to a raven, do you think that would be your reaction if he told you that your true love was going to die as a result?
No, I think my reaction would be, wait a minute, you're a raven, why the hell are you talking? But you know,
he's crazy, man.
So he
Michael.
He'd be a little disturbed by saying,
he accepts that the raven talks because he's crazy, so he just gets on with it.
So the raven talks and says he's going to kill
his
wife.
He says, no, look, you're just talking evil. She's so beautiful. I could never do anything bad to her. And you're an evil sorcerer raven, so, you know, you're done for. So he takes out a dagger.
He took out his dagger of fire and steel and struck down the raven through the heart on.
Through the heart. I think there's a mistake.
It's a printing mistake.
Good to have you back, Frank.
I thought it said heart on, which is a bit rude, I thought.
So the bird, the raven then like falls down dead, lying on the ground, and then Michael all of a sudden goes, hold on a second.
So he kills the raven.
Hold on a second, the raven's disappeared. Where's the raven gone? I struck it down.
He killed it.
It was lying
in
there.
The sea.
All I can see is my true love lying there with a wound where her heart used to be.
Hold on. Wait a minute, Dave. Dave, this is dark.
This is really dark. The problem is Crazy Michael has mistaken his true love for a raven.
Ah, she shouldn't have had that haircut.
She shouldn't have worn that feathery costume.
It's that new look.
It is.
Confused him. He's a crazy man.
She didn't
mess with his
head.
She
didn't look like a raven, though. He was imagining it.
Because he's Crazy Man Michael.
And the raven was right.
So
why? So his wife said, I'm going to die because
it was all part of his delusion.
I see, the whole thing.
The whole chap.
But the one real thing was
that there
was
a person there, that it was his wife.
So his delusion was so that he could make himself think that it was something which was out of his control because a raven told him.
Well, maybe we're getting a bit far into the psychology of Crazy Michael, but you know.
Too far in. What's the moral?
He's then walking along, and he's talking to the trees and stuff, and he's asking their pardon. He's basically saying that that he knows now that he has to carry the weight of his actions. So the moral is you have to realize that you have to accept the consequences of
but he
what
was
you
mad.
Do
he didn't know what was going
on.
And
bear that with you all your life. Well, he sobers up once he's killed his wife. Moral, he kind of suddenly snaps back into focus.
The moral should be the wife should have taken him to an asylum or something, tried to get him help.
No, the moral is you have to live with the consequence of your actions.
Okay.
The raven should have got out of the way.
If we'd had time to talk in depth about the last couple of verses, the moral would have been more poignant.
Is that your angle?
You know, yeah.
Crazy Man Michael.
Yes. It's time for Tom's Folk Odyssey, though, I think.
Not really an odyssey.
No, this is
it's more of a folk amble.
As Frank said earlier, more like something he recorded.
yeah.
Shall we
listen? I think the opening jingle will sum it up.
Yeah, well, the closing one will sum it up better, I think.
Tom's Folk Odyssey.
He's across the world.
It has come. He has pressed record.
Thank you.
So it's the end of the festival. Somehow I managed to get a caravan because we didn't have a tent, so we were just in the car. I've managed to scoop a caravan. Unfortunately, a big gale has come in, really more like a hurricane. I don't know if you can hear that outside. I'll open the door and hear the wind. Out here, it's windy. There's a lot of wind. I think it's just beginning to sort of start with driving rain. I'm going to head back into the caravan. Yeah, it's better in here. So no, a good festival. We had a barn dance, which was fun. A nice session around the fire over there with a number of people. Anyway, I'm reasonably drunk, so I'm going to call it a night. Oh, we've enjoyed the coverage of the Wiper Folk Festival, because that's all you're getting.
Tom's Folk Odyssey.
He's across the world.
It has come. It's inadequate.
Thanks, Tom. Thanks.
Yeah. I think it's fair to say
looking forward to the next instalment of How Windy Is It Outside the Caravan?
The New Zealand Weather Report.
From Edinburgh to New Zealand, and we've so far picked up that it's windy.
I think it's fair to say that Tom was unreasonably drunk.
Baby steps, Tom, baby steps.
Garden Sessions Letters Band.
Frank.
Dear Garden Sessions, I've just rediscovered this site and I'm enjoying the music again. I'm making a living with my bagpipes here in southern Spain. Hope that's going well. Busking and travelling with a medieval themed market at weekends. But apart from me and a couple of French accordion players, the folk music is basically flamenco, which is also mighty. But I'm told if I go north, I'll discover more pipes and Celtic music, so probably give that a go soon. I'm reading Tom's Folk Odyssey, which sounds wicked too. Not based on that last report, I hope. I'm glad to see the Garden Sessions is still going strong. All the best. Tom Gibbs, Granada in Spain, with the pipes in his hand.
Indeed, and I've got...
Jackals looked at me there. What are you talking about?
Actually, Dave, can you take the next letter?
I can. It says, "Hello, Garden Sessions. I have arrived safely in Rome, and in keeping with my intention to bring more music into my life, I went and bought a lovely acoustic guitar from a local music man. She is beautiful,
oh, nice.
And possibly the love of my life."
The music man, or the...
the guitar.
The guitar,
right. She's called Alessandra, and she's perfect in every way.
The music man? No, okay.
The guitar, I think. There's just one problem. I'm still learning the guitar, and I opted for the easiest song possible to learn first, Knocking on Heaven's Door.
Put it down.
Do you have any suggestions for good, easy-to-learn, easy-strumming pattern folk numbers that I can start to get to grips with so that me and Alessandra can start to make sweet, beautiful folk together? Cheers, Ali the Postman.
Well, the best suggestion I could say, go to Dave's Angles page on the website. There's loads of pounding tunes to learn.
They're all in G, C, and D.
Many of them are very simple.
Good luck, Ali the Postman.
Anyway, that's the Letters Bag podcast at gardensessions@cody.kid. Contact us. It's time, though, for our feature, Knockingorrach World Ceilidh 2008.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's finally here. Knockingorrach World Ceilidh 2008. It's going well so far. We have a flat tyre. Silver.
On the upside, Heart Hill Services is lovely at this time of morning.
It's very lovely. And we were lucky enough to lose our tyre literally 20 yards from the turnoff to the service station. So that was a piece of good fortune, at least.
It was very fortunate indeed. And now we're just sort of looking at the trucks and
we are contemplating having a bacon sandwich or something else from this lovely roadside grill type area. Jack is contemplating the damage. I'll just see if I can get a quick word with him now round at the other end of the car. Jack, have you got anything to say?
No, not at the moment. Music to the hills, people to the land. Silver.
It's Knockingorrach 2008, it's the 10th anniversary of this wonderful festival.
What a celebration!
Yeah, what a celebration. Dave.
They're going large. It is taking off this year. It's
It is the most enjoyable Knockingork I think I've been to so far. Frank, Tom, you should be here.
Silver, your thoughts on the Peatbog Fairies who are playing right now?
Oh, well, they're lovely. I mean, everyone is a merrymaking around me. And it's just sort of... everyone's moving.
Let's hear some more!
So it's day two of Knockingorrick World Ceilidh 2008. Myself and Silver and Dave are just sitting on the grass in front of Shieling's World, listening to the weird string band. Dave, what do you think to what you're hearing?
At the moment we're getting a kind of slow folk rendition of Material World by Madonna, which the crowd seems to be loving. I'm not too sure about, but I hear Weird String Band are very, very good, so I'm looking forward to some pounding folk at some point this afternoon.
Weird strings are made of this. Who are you to disagree? We travel the world at the seven seas. Everybody's loving the weird strings. Some of them want to amuse you. Some of them want to be on you. Some of them want to confuse you. Some of them are just confused.
It was sort of 3 o'clock in the morning and we were getting low on the stuff that we could remember how to play, so we just like put it open to all the people in the room and said, oh, what would you like us to play? And as usual, you get about five or six things being shouted out at once. So instead of trying to play one song at a time, we sort of tried to see how many we could do at the same time, so please more people. And
The rest is history.
So. Enjoyed doing that, and continue to do it ever since.
10 years for Knockingorrick now, since you've been coming. Has the festival changed at all?
The first time I came here, it got to about 7 o'clock on Friday night before they even put the sound system on the stage. Let alone hooked it up, and I guess here on Wednesday this year, and they were testing it as I arrived. It's got more organised. It has got a bit better. It seems to run more smoothly, and the stages looks a bit posher as well. Mm-hmm. But it's sort of a nice sort of hippie atmosphere that you tend to get here.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm sitting in the longhouse now. We're enjoying a few tunes, and I'm sitting here with Lewis. Lewis, is this your first Knockingorrick, or are you a veteran?
This is my second Knockingorrick.
And were you here September last year, or?
I was here for the hearth, freezing my bits off, and this is much more enjoyable.
It is really. It rained briefly last night, but apart from that, we've had sun for most of the festival so far, and hopefully that holds.
I'm joined now by festival goer Babette. How's your festival been going so far?
So far, it's been fantastic. The weather's come out now as well, so.
We're all loving the sunny weather. Missing the rain at all? It's the usual sort of Knockingorrick experience, you know.
Well, this is my first time at Knockingorrick, so no, I didn't. It was nice hearing the rain while I was sleeping in a van, and it was clear the next day. So
as a first time Knockingorricker, have you had any sort of highlights? Any sort of?
Well, we've been working at the stall, so we haven't really been out much. You sort of get to have a glimpse at the big stage. Went out to the dance tent, which was good. And there's a man on a whistle that keeps popping up everywhere. He's very good as well.
I think we bumped into him too, yes. He's just
Pan. The Norse god Pan, he reminded me of, I don't know.
We need to look out for him.
It's Saturday night. We're at the main stage. It's Capper Kelly Silver. Describe the crowd.
Well, they're going wild all around us. We're in the middle.
What he means to say is that it's like a windswept sea of folkies. I think that is what he meant to say. But continue with your own inimitable description all the same, Silver.
Yeah, well, as Dave said, it is rather like sea of folkies. With listening to Capper Kelly.
A windswept sea.
Capper Kelly. What did Capper Kelly sound like, Jack?
Capper Kelly sound like this.
Well,
Dave and Silver and myself are backstage at Knockingorick with Capra Kelly after a fantastic set. How do you find playing the sort of smaller festivals, the, I presume on a smaller scale than you would normally do?
As they say, size doesn't matter. I mean, the audience out there tonight were sensational, and you know, when you get an audience like that that are backing you 100%, you know, from the minute you walk on stage, you just sense that sort of, you know, liveliness, and people are into it and they just want to have a good time. So, you know, that's what makes it for us, you know, that's what's important.
The band Capra Kelly has been sort of known for making folk music more accessible. When you sort of started doing your act, was it, did you ever have any trouble from sort of the folk purists?
I'd say we probably did, yeah. Well, in the early years, we were quite traditional, although having said that, we always had a synthesizer, for example, so we always started off, we were always on the sort of, on bad footing with the purists, you know, the minute you bring a synthesizer in. So I think that was quite good from our point of view, because it meant that, you know, we never fell into that niche. So, and we always, I suppose we were always recognized for pushing the boat out a wee bit and never quite embracing that whole traditional thing. We've tried not to be precious about it, but obviously the roots and the core of the music, of what we do, is traditional music, and that's really important to us. And you know, we'd hope that we would never sort of alienate ourselves as a result of trying to be progressive, but it's always been important to us to be progressive, you know. I mean, I think we are probably on a natural decline as well as a band, you know. We've been together for 24 years or so.
Hopefully not.
And well, it's a sort of a slow winding down, shall we say. We're not ending, but we're not as full on as we were. We're getting old, you know. We've all got families, and so being on the road.
Four babies arriving in September.
As well, so being on the road, you know, 24/7 isn't as appealing as it used to be. Brilliant anti-war song. From John Martin. It's called Don't You Go. The Army and the Navy, they never will agree till all the men and all the boys are gone from
by Liz Holmes at the festival office. This is the 10th anniversary and 20th festival, so it's obviously a pretty special event. How do you find that the festival's progressed over the 10 years? I mean, do you think it's changed considerably since its early days?
Well, I would hope we've become more professional over the years. We are able now to afford higher profile artists. We run 4/5 venues now, when before obviously it was just the one. We have progressed quite a lot. I think we had 350 visitors for our first festival in June 1998, and now we're on about 2,500. So we have certainly progressed.
There's a lot of work obviously that goes on over the months in between the festivals, which leads up to them. I mean, how much goes on behind the scenes?
A lot. You know, there's so many different aspects. There's the artistic side, when you've got to select and book your artist and then negotiate with fees if you're able. Then, of course, you've got the stage, the production, which is the marquees. And then we always do a little bit of land reclamation. The land does belong to my husband and myself. And every year we turn either a bit of bog or a bit of forestry into parking and camping. There's staffing, of course, that's an enormous issue. There's funding, another enormous aspect.
And of course, just finish up by saying, it's been sunny this weekend, which is very, very rare at Knockingorick. It's the first festival I've come to which hasn't had rain, and I've got the wellies on to prove it.
Well, I'm really glad it has been 4 days virtually of sunshine. Fortunately, when people have come to our festival, And when we're taking bookings on the phone, a lot of them say, we don't care what the weather does, we're coming and we're going to enjoy ourselves, for which we are eternally grateful.
Well, thanks very much for joining us on the Garden Sessions, Liz Holmes. Congratulations on the anniversary of Knockingorach, and may it continue for another 10 years as well.
Well, I'm standing outside the Shealing tent just now, and I'm joined by Phil Kay. He's just done a fantastic set to a packed tent. How did you find it this afternoon?
Oh yeah, well, it's just what it's something secretly what you dream of. I think I sort of, you know, at festivals more than ever, you just think this could be the thing where it's all in line. You know, you just speak about what you've actually experienced and riff on it a bit and make things up just about what you're actually experiencing. That's all you want to do as a comedian. I do is just talk about what's happening. And if you come to a festival, tons of stuff happens, so you can talk about it to folks who are in it. So it's got the chance to be the best gig ever, and it's kind of, it was close to that in bits.
In she comes, I've danced near her a few times in this festival. Remember me from in front of you at the Peat Bog Fairies, and I was, went away to look for my friends, and I came back and I was behind you. I've seen you, I recognise you. Hands up everyone who's seen me dancing. Be among you! I get myself around a bit.
But then again, you, all weekend you're kind of having to hold yourself together a little bit so you can then speak. Oh God, it's agony and ecstasy. It's brilliant.
You almost wish you were staying this evening so you could let that kind of anticipation out and enjoy the festival fully.
Yeah. Or arrive straight away and do a gig straight away, because you've been last year, so you can talk about what you did last year. Anyway, I'd definitely come back, because it's little ones are what it's all about. Little manageable, and kids can just can walk the length and then come back. It's beautiful.
Once again, a fantastic set this afternoon, Phil Kay. Thanks very much.
Good luck, brother.
We're standing next to the main stage at Knockingorach. It's coming to a close. It's Sunday evening,
Dave.
But Orchestra del Sol are holding court at the moment. Jack, have you found Orchestra del Sol so far?
Oh, they're very good. You can hear them in the background. I mean, they are very, very, very good.
And how's your weekend been, your Knockingorach Festival?
It's been pounding.
Good
best
stuff.
Yet.
Silver, how have you found this year's Knockingorach Festival?
Well, I mean, it's been wonderful, as always. It's been a repetition of all the good things that we've had since we started coming. And I think it's a very good tune on the stage here. I think we should have a listen.
Well, here we are once again. The dusty trail awaits. It is very dusty, of course, given the sunshine that we've had. There's been no mud. There's been some lovely music. Jack, Knockingorach, 2008. How's it been?
It has been pounding, I have to say. Highlights for me being Orchestra del Sol, and the toilets, I thought, were very, very good this year. They're very clean. Could have done with the stove and the acoustic tent, though. That's still lacking. But all in all, a wonderful weekend.
And it is indeed that Knockingorach spirit that makes it all so worthwhile. Well, we're off back to Edinburgh now. If any listeners know of any better festivals, then please do let us know. But as far as we know, this is the one.
This is the best festival you're going to get.
Indeed, very much.
And we'll be back for the Hearth, obviously, in September. Cannot wait.
As always.
The toilets were very clean this year.
I was amazed.
They were very
I really
clean.
Was. And the weather was fantastic.
For,
and
like,
the music was brilliant.
The festival was longer as well.
Yeah.
I'm glad I wasn't there. But,
yeah, it was shocking.
But, you know, what can you do?
Oh, I was going to bring this up in the letters bag, but we didn't have time. There was a thing on the feedback from somebody asking about correct pronunciation. And Frank said he would step up
Gustavo
to the challenge.
Gustavo Santaolalla is who... The
yeah.
bit of tune time you
that's
played
how you
last
do it,
week.
Jack.
Hang my head.
Don't.
That's
shame.
The seasoned tongue of
I
a jet-setting traveller.
Yes, I hang my head in shame, as I
Podcast.
Say.
Jingle saved you.
Frank, on next week's show.
Next week's show, Folky News. Dave's Angle, the official download chart will I still be at number one?
Who knows? Who can say, Frank?
I hope so. I might just get on the computer and start downloading them myself.
Doesn't work that way.
Okay.
There are restrictions. There's security.
We're covered.
All the teams of people.
All the usuals. Listeners, please join us again.
GardenSessions.co.uk, contest at podcast.gardensessions.co.uk. But this is the Garden Sessions. From myself, Jack Foster, Dave Dangles, Gimble, and Frank Burkitt. Take it easy.
See you later.
Cheerio.
Mm-hmm.